We've got 70,000 nuclear weapons. 100 of them would destroy either country.
The 80s had to do more with AIDS than anything else.
All kinds of displays of wealth.
I remember in the 80s, where did all of these folks come from who were looking for a place to stay?
Oh my God, we're having an earthquake. Wait a minute, hold on.
We had a blast.
I think everybody in the Bay Area had a good time.
It was a great ride.
San Francisco in the 1980s. It was a great ride along a sometimes bumpy road. Our city by the bay entered the decade under a dark shadow of assassinations and mass suicides that ripped the city to its core at the end of the 1970s.
Both Mayor Moscone and Supervisor Harvey Milk have been shot and killed.
It was a shattered city, still the aftermath of the twin assassinations, Mayor George Moscone, Supervisor Harvey Milk, Jonestown. 900 San Franciscans went to their death in Guyana. Following the White Night Riot, there were real divisions within the city.
As a city, we had done a lot of self-questioning already when the early 80s came around. And I remember feeling a certain sense of expectation. What is this decade going to be about?
From a dark shadow to the bright light of a nuclear mushroom, the 1980s ushered in a renewed fear of all things nuclear. Gone was the naivete of the 1950s duck and cover exercises. Suddenly, we were seeing real scenarios of what a nuclear attack would look like, and San Francisco was ground zero.
A single explosion, an airburst at 7,000 feet over downtown San Francisco, let's say today, now, at this moment.
When a group of doctors calling themselves Physicians for Social Responsibility held their first conference in San Francisco in 1980, they dropped the bomb on us.
Of the 3 million people in the San Francisco metropolitan area, 780,000 would be killed outright.
Their gruesome account of how the Bay Area would suffer in a nuclear attack was documented in The Last Epidemic, a film that was shown thousands of times in churches, schools, even in Congress, and was pivotal to the anti-nuclear movement that would take hold in the 80s.
It epitomized our fears and caused us literally to be galvanized. You felt, I am in such a hot seat, I'll do one of two things. I will close my eyes and completely forget it, pretend it's not there, or, my God, I've got to do something.
You are requested to leave. If you do not leave the property, you will be arrested.
Bay Area activists focused their fears on the Central California coast. The nuclear power plant at Diablo Canyon had been under construction for 12 years. In September of 1981, it was ready to go online. Protesters rallied their forces for one last attempt to stop it, with the largest act of civil disobedience in California's history.
No nukes! No nukes!
We had wave after wave after wave of people that blocked that front gate. There were so many people, we would have filled the jail many times over. So they actually put us in two gyms.
If we go to jail!
Thousands were arrested. It was costing the state $50,000 a day, but not having much effect on the plans to fire up Diablo.
They will have absolutely no impact on fuel loading in Diablo Canyon Unit 1.
Then came the drama that couldn't have been scripted better in Hollywood. Just one day before the plant was to begin fuel loading, a PG&E engineer revealed that the plant had major design flaws.
A company engineer was rechecking blueprints. He noticed that seismic safety supports designed for unit number 2 had actually been installed in unit number 1.
We felt elated that our courage to go down and get our arms twisted by the police and sit in front of trucks had somehow given some courage to at least one of the workers at Diablo Canyon to tell the truth.
But the reprieve was only temporary. It took 3 more years to correct the mistakes. but Diablo Canyon Nuclear Power Plant went online in 1984.
They are the focus of evil in the modern world.
The Soviet Union had been declared the enemy by President Reagan, and the anti-nuclear sentiment was not registering in Washington. The president launched the biggest peacetime defense buildup in history, and nuclear arsenals topped the list. Concern was mounting as Californians passed a statewide nuclear freeze initiative. But President Reagan pushed on. In 1983, he called for a strategic defense initiative, more commonly known as Star Wars. Its development would get underway right here in the Bay Area at the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory. Protesters clogged the gates to Livermore week after week, calling for an end to weapons development.
Hey, you're all under arrest. We're blocking the roadway.
The work did not stop. By the end of the decade, more than $30 billion had been poured into the program. But Star Wars was never realized. While high-tech weapons were being developed, the United States was sending more conventional weapons to Central America to fight President Reagan's war on communism. Again, the Bay Area was involved. Weekly shipments of munitions headed for Central America were coming out of the Concord Naval Weapons Station. In 1987, peace activists began a vigil to block the munitions trains. Brian Wilson was among those who sat on the tracks one morning in September, fully expecting to stop the train and then be arrested.
So as the train started coming, I just assumed the train was going to stop, as did everybody else. But instead, it seemed to be accelerating.
The train did not stop. It ran over Wilson, severing both his legs.
I have to say that I don't have any regrets. I'm sorry I lost my legs. I'm sorry that people go through this all over the world all the time when they're standing up to repression. But there's something about the deep joy of expressing one's consciousness in an honest way.
The wars in Central America had another impact on San Francisco. The Latino population more than doubled in the 1980s as people fled the violence in their countries. Though they were here illegally, San Francisco declared itself a city of refuge. Bay Area churches provided sanctuary in a defiant act against the federal government. Most of those who came have since become legal residents. Many have become U.S. citizens. In fact, the decade ushered in a whole new era of immigration in San Francisco. Southeast Asians fleeing Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos transformed the Tenderloin.
Between 5 and 6,000 children have moved into the most notorious 30 blocks of the city.
The new immigrant families were settling in the only place they could afford. By the end of the decade, they had made it their home. The Tenderloin bustled with more than 150 new businesses, as well as new schools, parks, and playgrounds. The Golden Gate has seen wave after wave of new immigrants over the decades. The 80s were no different, as the face of our city continued to change. The liberation movement played itself out to the fullest in the 1970s in San Francisco. But the party came to a screeching halt in 1978 with the assassination of Supervisor Harvey Milk, the country's first openly gay politician. After the riots and the grief, gays reassessed and reemerged a more cohesive community.
I think the late 70s were really the period of sex and drugs and rock and roll, and the 80s marked the point when the gay community really blossomed far beyond that.
Don't nobody bring me no bad news.
The San Francisco Gay Men's Chorus formed on the steps of City Hall the night Supervisor Milk was murdered. By 1981, it had become a world-class singing group and took its show on a cross-country tour.
We knew we were making history. We knew it was the first time any of this had been done. We were the first chorus with gay in our name. We were the first chorus to go on tour.
And I remember being in the audience, in the group of people in the Castro who were there to receive the chorus back to town. The street was packed that day as the buses came back from the airport to a hero's welcome to the chorus. It was a magic moment.
But the magic was soon to give way to more tragedy.
The day we left on tour, the Chronicle had a feature story on the inside pages. And over in the corner on the very same page was a little story about a gay pneumonia.
Well, at, when was he, 15 or 16?
I was 15.
15, he sat us down and very seriously told us that he was gay. And it was very traumatic for him and for us too. So I suppose at that time AIDS was being mentioned in the paper, and I remember we kind of told him to be careful.
And of course he was invincible. It wouldn't happen to him.
Michael Stone was one of the earliest and youngest victims of a disease doctors knew nothing about.
He became sick and was admitted to the hospital because his pediatrician had seen these enlarged lymph nodes in his lung. And then the lymph nodes returned to normal. And then there, after a while, there wasn't even a need to watch it anymore.
Michael was only 15. After those first symptoms in 1980, the disease went into hiding, just as it had in so many gay men in the early 80s.
I had finished my training in cancer medicine at UCSF. I finished at the end of June 1981.
Dr. Paul Volberding was a young oncologist leaving the research lab to take a job at San Francisco General Hospital.
A doctor up at UC who had been coming down here to sort of take care of the cancer patients before I arrived patted me on the back and said, "Paul, there's the next great disease waiting for you at SFGH. There's a patient with Kaposi sarcoma." He was joking. I mean, he didn't really think it was the next great disease. But it turned out that he was right.
Kaposi sarcoma was a skin cancer, the lesions soon to be associated with AIDS.
They are concerned that it is attacking heavily in the gay community, and they're working on theories to explain why.
There was a period of intense anxiety. We didn't know anything about it. We didn't know how to diagnose it. We didn't know how it was transmitted. We didn't know what the incubation period was. We didn't know that we weren't already infected.
It would take another year and a half before they knew enough to finally give it a name. Acquired immune deficiency syndrome, AIDS. In January 1983, San Francisco had 150 cases and more being discovered every day. It was that month San Francisco General opened the first AIDS clinic. Alison Moed was head nurse of what was known as Ward 5B.
We were excited and we were expectant, and we just were waiting for those patients to come in so we could take care of them. I don't think we could have believed or imagined what it was really going to be like. The numbers that would die, the ways that people would sicken, the grief, the sadness.
The number of AIDS cases more than tripled that first year. To help them cope, nurses in 5B started a book to memorialize the men who had passed through.
I don't think that we thought we'd need another book. I really don't. If anyone had asked me, I would have been sure that a few years, a couple of years, this will stop. This can't go on.
The first time that we knew that something serious was wrong was in one morning when the phone rang, and it was a doctor from Santa Cruz that was calling us, and he said, if you want to see your son alive, you better get down here real quick.
Michael was now 19, going to college in Santa Cruz when he was hospitalized and diagnosed with AIDS.
Here, all these people are walking around with this, you know, suits on and afraid to touch him, afraid of him, afraid that somehow he was going to infect them.
This was for
only 70 miles from San Francisco, but it seemed a world away when it came to treating patients with AIDS.
So it really traumatized him, and it was very disturbing to us. I mean, that was no way to treat anybody.
Ralph and Judy brought their son back to San Francisco. He died 4 months later, one of almost 500 people who had died of AIDS in San Francisco by 1984.
My lover and I didn't split up, Michael said. He died of AIDS.
Armistead Maupin, the author of a series of fictional books about life in San Francisco called Tales of the City, was the first to chronicle the advent of AIDS in his work.
In the end, I had no choice because I was watching it happen around me. And I wanted other people to feel the impact of that.
In 1983, one of Maupin's most beloved characters became the first ever to die of AIDS in fiction. The sudden death of this fictional character was not unlike what was happening every day in the Castro. With no early diagnosis and no treatment, it seemed people were disappearing overnight.
There were times when you didn't even know a person had it, and you would hear that they were gone, and you hadn't seen them in a few weeks, and they were diagnosed and were gone.
Nothing is worse for any of us than the unknown.
As the numbers of the dying grew, city officials realized they faced the biggest public health crisis of our time.
The early numbers were terrifying to me. Let me be very honest. They were very small, but they were very terrifying because 3 or 4 years into it, we began to see the death rate. There were some estimates what proportion of people would find it fatal. And at one point, we reached the conclusion 100%. And that was a devastating realization. I'll never forget that.
Mayor Dianne Feinstein was getting no help from the federal government. This was a San Francisco problem, a gay problem.
We will sink with the weight of this epidemic.
The city and the gay community pulled together. Working with the medical establishment, they developed what would become known as the San Francisco model, an approach to dealing with AIDS that would be copied around the world. But there was one issue early on that nearly tore them apart. The city's gay bathhouses, commercial businesses where men went for sex.
I don't believe that this city has any business permitting businesses to operate whose sole source of being is the very activity that communicates the disease.
Mayor Feinstein was unequivocal. She wanted the bathhouses shut down. Dr. Mervyn Silverman was the city's health director. It would be his job to do it, but he did not agree.
If people change their behavior, we could stop the spread of the disease today. What we want to do is change activity regardless of where it takes place.
The issue played itself out in full view of the media for more than a year before a decision was finally made in 1985.
Today, I have ordered the closure of 14 commercial establishments which promote and profit from the spread of AIDS.
For some, it was too soon. For others, it was too late. If I had to do it all over again, I don't know that I would have done it any differently with the circumstances that existed then, because those bathhouses at a certain point in time were symbols. You know, that was a place before gay liberation where people could go somewhat anonymously, and it had a lot of meaning, I think, in the community.
But by now, doctors knew that this disease had no sexual preference.
Here at the AIDS clinic in San Francisco, as many as 3 women a week are coming in for AIDS screening.
Women were contracting it and passing it on to their babies. Hemophiliacs were infected through tainted blood supplies. By 1985, we were seeing a second epidemic, an epidemic of fear and discrimination. People with AIDS were losing their jobs, their apartments. Children were being kicked out of school.
No AIDS in public school! No AIDS in public school!
Still, the federal government did nothing. President Reagan hadn't even publicly said the word AIDS.
If you're going to San Francisco,
5 years after they returned from that jubilant tour, members of the gay men's chorus began to die. 10, 20, 30. Voices that would never be heard again.
The whole universe depends on this game. The world is falling apart. Reagan is president. And it all depends on Joe Montana.
The 1980s could go down as one of the most exciting decades in sports we'll ever see. The Oakland Raiders kicked it off with a Super Bowl win in 1981, their second championship title in 4 years, but their last game representing the Bay Area. The next season, the team moved to Los Angeles. In college football, who could forget what is now simply known as the play? November 1982, rivals Stanford and Cal at Memorial Stadium. Everyone thought Stanford had it clinched. But there were 4 seconds left in this game.
Ball comes loose and the Bears have to get out of bounds. Rodgers along the sideline, another one. They're still in deep trouble at midfield. They tried to do a couple of... The ball is still loose as they get it to Rodgers. They give it back now to the 30. They're down to the 20. Oh, the band is out on the field. He's going to go into the end zone. He's going into the end zone. Will it count?
Five lateral passes later, Cal's Kevin Mohn plows into the end zone through spectators and band members for a touchdown as the clock expires.
The Bears have won! The Bears have won! Oh, my God!
Gary Tyrrel was the Stanford trombone player who couldn't get out of the way.
California has won the big game over Stanford.
All the band's folks sort of peeled away as they saw him running down, except for me. I'm guessing that he probably wanted to spike the ball, and I was in the wrong place at the wrong time.
But there was another play in football that year that changed the whole psyche of San Francisco. This one, known as the catch, marked a crucial turning point for the 49ers, from the losingest team in the NFL to the superpower of the decade.
Just got to be playing outside. I don't know what's going to happen to him, but I do know that...
After only 2 years under Coach Bill Walsh, in 1981, the young team made it to the NFC playoffs to face the formidable Dallas Cowboys. No one gave them a chance until the last minute of the game, when quarterback Joe Montana and receiver Dwight Clark made a connection that made history.
Looking, throwing in the end zone. He's 6'4", he stands about 10 feet tall in this crowd's estimation.
I'm just very happy that the fans can hold on to one thing that I did during my career. There are players that play great their whole career, and they remember the player, but there's not really any defining moment for them. And I don't think there's any question that that's a defining moment for me.
San Francisco erupted. We were headed to our first Super Bowl. Super Bowl 16. The 49ers pulled out a 26-21 victory over Cincinnati.
But the highlight was, after winning the Super Bowl in 1981, early in 1982, there was to be a parade through San Francisco, down Market Street, and I wasn't for that. I said, who would ever come out to a parade like that? When we turned down Market Street, I couldn't believe it. People say there were 200,000 people there. Who knows? But everyone was there. There was just this delirious excitement and pride that they had begun to take in their team and in their city.
Ladies and gentlemen, will the San Francisco 49ers please stand?
I'll never forget it. Millions of people were on the streets. I mean, the parade was something I couldn't believe. It was very important in the psyche of the city at the time, because once again, we became the city that knows how.
Coach Bill Walsh was now being called the genius. Joe Montana, named MVP, was proving his greatness, and everyone was having a good time.
The personalities are different back then, and they fit together, and we did have a lot of fun. You know, we worked hard, and I think in the process of knowing that we had to work hard, that we got some things accomplished that I don't think a lot of people felt we could do.
By 1984, Walsh had built the team into a machine. It ripped through its opponents for an 18-1 record, the most successful season in NFL history.
It changed dramatically from being this youthful, effervescent, impulsive, impetuous team to later becoming more of a machine-like, precision-like organization to remain on the top.
Super Bowl 19, they were on top again, facing the Miami Dolphins. The game was on home turf, Stanford Stadium, and fans were doing just about anything to get there, including paying $1,000 or more for tickets.
Coach Bill Walsh and the remainder of the San Francisco 49ers.
It definitely felt like a home game. And then I think the thing that really made everybody go, well, this is our game, is the fact that the fog came in. And it was like, this is everyday San Francisco weather, look out, you know, this is an omen for us.
The 49ers soundly beat Miami 38-16, and Joe Montana secured his place as the NFL's top quarterback with a second MVP title. Two more years of getting hit, and Montana's injuries were taking their toll. In 1987, he was in and out of the game.
It's kind of catch-22. If you don't play when you're hurt, oh, he can't play when he's hurt. If you play when you're hurt, well, why'd you play when you were hurt? So you sit there, you don't know what to do.
Even after back surgery, he continued to play, but his performance was lackluster. The big question going into the 88 season was, would he be replaced with Steve Young? Both quarterbacks played in what started out a dismal season, but things turned around as the playoffs neared.
Joe came back, was 100% healthy right at the end of the year. And we came back and had two of the greatest playoff games in our history against Minnesota and the Bears, and went on to win the Super Bowl. And Joe again demonstrated that he was the great one.
The 49ers won their third Super Bowl with an amazing 90-yard drive in the final minutes of the game.
He's in motion. Montana.
And there seems to be a little football left in Mr. Montana.
It was a bittersweet day for the powerhouse team. Montana was back on top, but his future was still uncertain. And Bill Walsh, the man who had built this dynasty, had decided to retire.
Was this the final game on the sideline for great coach Bill Walsh?
I was emotionally fatigued and decided that that should be enough. Should I have stayed? Probably. But at the time, it seemed the thing I sort of had to do.
After a decade on top, Walsh handed the team over to George Seifert, who took the 49ers to a repeat Super Bowl win in 1990. 10 years, 8 NFC appearances, and 4 Super Bowls. The San Francisco 49ers were indisputably the team of the decade. Area's biggest success story, not just of the decade, but of the century, a place in time, a confluence of events that created the PC revolution. Two Steves, Jobs and Wozniak, led the revolution. They were the first to make a business out of putting a keyboard, display, and microprocessor together in a machine that people could actually use. By 1980, these two 20-somethings were already multimillionaires.
All of a sudden, you know, we were just kind of sitting where we were, almost in a lucky place. You know, this huge market was evolving, and we had one of the key products.
But competition was on the way, and more than just one company, an entire industry was about to be born. In 1980, IBM, the corporate computer giant, decided to tap this new consumer market. A little-known semiconductor company in Santa Clara named Intel was chosen to make the microprocessors to power an IBM PC.
Well, IBM's decision to use Intel's microprocessor was very important for us because it was the critical decision that has been the foundation of our business ever since.
The IBM PC made its debut and started cutting into Apple's exclusive market. Others soon followed. Dozens of computer makers started producing PCs, and new businesses making everything from circuit boards to keyboards set up shop in the Santa Clara Valley.
Down the line, this whole area might become the home of highly paid professionals.
This agricultural valley was now officially Silicon Valley, a mixed blessing for the silicon makers who remembered when.
Remember when 101 was a three-lane road with one stoplight between San Jose and Redwood City, where I lived?
Fruit orchards gave way to high-priced condos. Real estate prices skyrocketed, and that three-lane highway was soon choked with cars.
It was no longer fun to drive my Porsche to work. So I got a diesel rabbit instead. And just the whole nature of the area changed.
The industry was about to see big changes as well. In 1984, Apple introduced the first Macintosh.
We shall prevail.
The tone of the ad and the tone of the company and our philosophies really said, you know, fight this mentality to be just like everyone else and, you know, go out and be different and live a graphical world and be creative.
A computer that anyone could operate, pointing to windows with an arrow navigated by a mouse. It was a whole new concept. By the end of the decade, personal computers were part of our everyday lives, and the new millionaires making them were household names. Silicon Valley wasn't the only place creating millionaires. The Bay Area was a place to make money, and more importantly, to show everyone you were making money.
There have always been 25 to 35-year-olds, but never so many with so much money.
I think they just have higher standards for themselves materially.
This emphasis on, I gotta get mine and you get yours the best way you can, and I'm gonna let you know that I have mine, was considered quite chic.
People were making a killing in transitory real estate deals, banking, and stock market transactions. And everyone, whether they were really making money or not, wanted to emulate the lifestyle. For many, that lifestyle included cocaine, the champagne of drugs. It became the ultimate status symbol.
Cocaine. The drug of choice, the drug of the 80s.
It was the drug of the elite, a drug most people didn't even think was addictive, and yet they were selling off fortunes to feed their habits. The excess of the 80s meant big money for the music industry as well. Record sales skyrocketed. Musicians were selling more music than ever before.
Everything got big, you know, business was big, let's do bigger business, let's sell more records, bigger benefits, bigger. And from what I've
seen, I believe them. Image was as important as the music in the 1980s. The advent of music videos and MTV created rock stars overnight, like the Bay Area's Huey Lewis and the News.
We were absolute beneficiaries of the video age, there's no question about that.
The news is very good about MTV, right, guys?
Right. Harder rock and roll.
What they did was they helped us sell as many copies of our record. You know, our sports record sold 9 million copies. Without video, we wouldn't have been able to reach everybody like that.
Technology was key. Videos and the introduction of compact discs in the mid-80s made for unprecedented record sales. And it changed the sound as well. Drum machines and synthesizers meant you no longer had to have a band to sound like one.
The problem, I guess, from the standpoint of the 80s was we gave all these youngsters these tools that made it easy for them to crank out music, but none of them had kind of suffered at all. You know, none of them, it was like a hobby gone crazy.
Todd Rundgren was at the forefront of integrating the new technology with music.
the 80s was not a great period in music. You know, most people agree that it wasn't. All of the action was in computers. That was the reason why I moved out here.
The technology coming out of the Silicon Valley was allowing artists like Rundgren to create sounds and images we had never seen before. There was another new sound coming out of the Bay Area in the 80s, the Oaktown sound. Rap had been around since the late 70s, but one guy from Oakland is credited with introducing it to the world in the late 80s. MC Hammer was the first rapper to be picked up by a major record label. And when he put out his Please Hammer Don't Hurt Him album, rap was no longer underground.
Can't touch this.
Well, it introduced a lot of people to rap who hadn't listened to rap, who had, no idea what rap really was all about.
Stop. Hammer time. Go with the flow. It is said if you can't rule the list, you probably are dancing away.
Please Hammer, Don't Hurt Him. The title is like, okay, now I'm getting ready to do my thing. Now don't make me have to hurt you. You know, which simply means, you know, I'm going to fight to put my music out there is what Please Hammer, Don't Hurt Him was all about. And people saw that and they could relate to it.
That album sold more than 10 million copies. The 1980s had spawned a new form of music. The Oaktown sound would become one of the biggest money makers in the industry.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Those enduring images of 80s excess were deceiving. There was another side to this decade's story.
There was phenomenal growth in the number of millionaires. Phenomenal growth, unlike any other place that had ever happened in the world. And simultaneously, there was a phenomenal growth in poverty.
It was showing itself on the streets, in the growing lines at places like St. Anthony's Dining Hall in the Tenderloin.
I started seeing in the 80s, and I neglected, or I didn't want to say it because it was such a cliche, but I noticed more of a vast difference between the haves and the have-nots.
It's still hard times for a lot of people. We see a lot of victims of unemployment. I've never seen so many women and children as this year.
Nights were particularly hard for these new homeless. There were not many shelters. Glide Memorial Church was just a few blocks from St. Anthony's.
It was awful. I remember Glide having to open up its facilities because we didn't have any facilities then to keep people. But what we did, we opened up our halls and put cots in the halls, and people slept in the halls. This was in the 80s.
We don't yet know exactly why, what they're back.
While city officials tried to figure it out, hotels, YMCAs, even muni buses were used to give these people shelter.
The idea was that for some reason it was a temporary crisis. And if you were able to take people off the street, they could get their life back together again.
But the crisis was anything but temporary. By the late 80s, homeless encampments had become a regular part of our urban landscape. The biggest, right next to City Hall.
They were locating close to where the power was. They wanted the power to see them and say, uh-huh, yeah, this is a problem.
The situation only got worse in 1987 when a new drug hit the streets, crack cocaine. It was more addictive and more destructive than anything we had seen before.
Crack, 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 everywhere you go, crack.
An inner-city street drug, it took its heaviest toll on the African-American community. It ripped families apart. Mothers and grandmothers became addicts. When those mothers began giving birth to shaking, drug-addicted babies, Reverend Cecil Williams feared for the future of a whole generation of African-Americans. He called a national conference at Glide Church.
I was hopeless. I did that first conference. We called it the Death of the Race. I did the second conference called The Rebirth of a Race. And I was hedging on that one. Okay, I really was.
Let's join hands and hearts and lives.
That morning, I will never forget it. I always sang gospel and spirituals. And people prayed because we were going to make sure that the death of a race would not become a reality.
The same year we were dealing with a new drug epidemic, the epidemic of AIDS raged on. In 1987, President Reagan finally acknowledged the disease.
We've declared AIDS public health enemy number one.
But by now, 1,000 San Franciscans a year were dying.
I remember that the logjam finally broke and Reagan mentioned the name AIDS. I also remember just as clearly that it didn't mean a damn thing.
There were developments like the HIV antibody test and AZT, the first effective AIDS treatment. But for many, progress was too slow and frustration was growing.
The culture had become somewhat jaded to the notion of AIDS and had settled into the idea of it. And I think that's why we saw so much serious radical gay activism at the time.
The construction of a huge quilt may not have seemed radical when the first squares were pieced together in the shop on Market Street in 1987. But the name's Project Quilt became more than just a memorial to the dead. When the panels were taken to Washington, D.C. and spread out in full view of the president, the sheer magnitude of the disease could not be denied.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States could not be here today, but he will be overhead.
No more deaths! No more deaths!
1989 saw more radical protest by a group appropriately named ACT UP. Blocking morning commuters on the Golden Gate Bridge was a desperate attempt to get attention, as protesters demanded more funding, faster FDA drug approval, and cheaper drugs for AIDS patients.
These are the best protection we have against AIDS. Get them.
By the end of the decade, the focus was shifting from finding a cure for AIDS to living with the disease. And San Francisco could be proud of how it handled one of the most insidious epidemics in history.
It's really impressive, it seems to me, in retrospect, that we saw an unknown epidemic, almost 100% fatal virus infection, come through a city, infect 35 or 40,000 people, and not induce panic. I think that we did a good job in retrospect.
Francisco knows how to throw a party. Where else would 700,000 people come out to celebrate a bridge? As we celebrated history in our corner of the world in 1987, history was being made around the world. The Cold War ended, and the nuclear threat gave way to arms control. Communism began to crumble. By 1989, the wall came down in Berlin, and tanks were mowing people down in Beijing. New faces were in charge. Change was in the air. And the Bay Area was buoyed once again by its sports teams. For the first time in history, the World Series would be played by our two Bay Area baseball teams.
Let's go A's! Let's go A's!
I have my money bet on the A's, but I'm rooting for the Giants.
Game day, October 17th, 1989. By 5 o'clock, Candlestick Park was packed with fans waiting for the Battle of the Bay to begin.
At second base, so the Oakland A's take
the lead. Hey,
but the game would have to wait as Mother Nature had the last word on this decade.
Oh my God, we're having an earthquake. Wait a minute.
Move! Move!
Ladies and gentlemen, the game has been called. Please leave the stadium in an orderly manner.
Upper deck of the Bay Bridge has collapsed on Oakland side.
The upper deck of the Bay Bridge has collapsed.
We hope the worst part is over. The lights are out. The power's out. Just hang on.
There's a gas leak. Let's go. Turn around here that way.
That's the Cypress Interchange. Upper level, apparently, has fallen in parts onto the level below it.
15 seconds of shaking changed our world, and the people of the Bay Area responded in heroic fashion.
We need something to pry the door.
And you need something to pry the door.
West Oakland residents risk their lives crawling between the slabs of concrete of the Cypress Freeway, looking for anyone who might be alive.
It's terrible. It's terrible. There's a lot of people under there that's pinned.
Hello? Hello?
Marina residents in San Francisco searched for neighbors and pulled fire hoses to save their homes.
San Franciscans rose to the occasion. Almost every San Francisco, I saw an accountant directing traffic at Venice and California Street because the traffic lights were out and people actually obeying.
It's just the way we feel about the city, it's ours.
As the sun set over San Francisco that night, our normally foggy skies were filled with an eerie glow of fire and smoke. No one slept, and many had nowhere to sleep.
We've got the clothes that we have on, that's it.
We have each other. And that's the main thing.
That's
the main thing.
There was this extraordinary moment where everything stopped and people simply became humans dealing with the world.
As a new day dawned, we realized the extent of the quake. Pegged at 7.1 on the Richter scale, it's centered in the South Bay. Towns as far south as Santa Cruz had been ripped apart. Thousands were homeless.
The Marina District, a 36-block area, has been declared a disaster area.
In San Francisco, hundreds of Marina residents were realizing they would never go back to their damaged homes, not even to collect their most precious belongings. In Oakland, the rescue efforts continued around the clock at the Cypress Freeway, but there was no one to rescue. With each passing day, we were losing hope until 4 days after the quake.
The mood is jubilant here in Oakland now that someone in all of his wreckage, amazingly enough, has been found alive.
Buck Helm, the man pulled from the collapsed freeway, died a month later. The 67th victim of the Loma Prieta quake. But his rescue had given the Bay Area the emotional lift it needed to get on with rebuilding itself.
It was the first ray of hope for recovery. It said that we're gonna get out of this. We're gonna come back from this.
11 days after the quake, the World Series was finally played. The A's won it in a 4-game sweep.
We showed not only the country, but the entire world that San Francisco, with all of its diversity, with all of what the world sees so often as kind of a kooky kind of population, we showed the entire world how to pull together.
It was a dramatic end to the 1980s. Through it, San Francisco and the whole Bay Area formed a new sense of community, one that would take us into the decade ahead.